Sir. Hey guys, open your Bibles up to Acts chapter 2. Acts is in your New Testament. It's the fifth book of your New Testament. It's Acts chapter 2. So Matthew, Mark, Luke, John, Acts, fifth book. Open it up to Acts 2. I just wanted to share with you, in light of even this, what Jeff was just talking about in the connecting to Christ, being in community and engaging in the call, I wanted to kind of specifically bring you up to speed on where we are with the property that we own. A little over a year ago, the church was blessed to be able to buy 6 acres up on Happy Valley Road, and by God's grace and your generosity, we were able to do that debt-free, so we owe nothing on it. And things have been progressing, and God has been showing His favor, and so we haven't talked about it in a long time. A lot of that is because we don't want to make a building the thing, but I just want to bring you up to speed as family, because this is what family does, as we talk about family business. And so in Acts 2, if you look at Acts 2, I'm going to start in verse 42, it says this. Acts 2:42, it says this. It says, they were continually devoting themselves to the apostles' teaching and to fellowship and to the breaking of bread and to prayer. So there are four things listed there at least that the church is supposed to be about. And it says, and everyone kept feeling a sense of awe, and many wonders and signs were taking place through the apostles. And all those who believed were together. So get that. There's a corporate witness there that the believers were together. And there's power in that togetherness in the church. And that's what most of the rest of the New Testament is about, is the power of the togetherness of the gospel. And then it says, and had all things in common. There's that togetherness again. And they began selling their property and possessions and were sharing them all with all and anyone that for anyone who might have need and caring for one another. And as a body, guys, I've never been a part of a group of people that just jumped in and helped each other the way you guys do and care for each other. And even for those that are outside of our body that you guys jump in and help and pray for and take meals to. And verse 46, day by day, continuing with one mind in the temple, so they were worshiping at church and breaking bread and house from house to house, so they were worshiping in their homes. They were taking meals together, we're going to do that today, with gladness and sincerity of heart. So they were just doing life. They were doing, it was all, in every aspect of their life, they were walking along together, and it says, and praising God and having favor with all the people. Now here comes the engage part. Here comes the engaging in the community for the sake of the gospel of Jesus Christ. And the Lord was adding to their number day by day those who were being saved. And guys, that's the family that we see being knit together here at Cornerstone, not by me, not by the elders, not by the deacons, but by the grace of God and the power of His Spirit. But part of what led us to even planting the church 6 years ago was that we felt that there was a need in the body of Christ for a church that really celebrated the togetherness of and the power of a corporate witness. Yes, we are called to be witnesses individually. Yes, we are called to be witnesses as a family in our neighborhoods and in our places of work and in school. But there is a power of the body gathered, not just on Sundays in a building, but in houses and in other places. There's a power in a corporate witness that has been in some ways diminished in the church today. I think what hit me last summer, so not this summer, but last summer, was this. It's going to come up on the screen. It says, it's not only the individual Christian believer who is set their light, who is to let their light shine, a narrow beam of torchlight in the world, but each local church is to be a lighthouse, a great wide beam of gospel light illuminating the surrounding darkness. And one of the things I've noticed over the last few weeks, so we were blessed. Today we have to go, we're back to tearing down and putting everything away and setting up every Sunday. And we've done that for much of our existence. So we're used to that. But one of the things I noticed in the last few Sundays is I was hanging out after church and I'm watching what's going on around me as I'm meeting new people. The number of people that have been staying after church, because for a long time, 2/3 of us would stay for an hour after church, it felt like. And we were kicking everybody out the door because at the facility we were at before, we had access to it when we wanted it. The school just gave us a key and a code. So on Sundays, we had a lot of flexibility. We don't have that flexibility here. They're gracious to let us in when they can find someone to open and close, and that's where we're at. So what happened through all of last year, because we moved in here last summer, for those of you that don't know, what happened all of last year during the school year was I started to see, without even really noticing it at first, the amount of fellowship going on, the one another's happening, the conversations, the praying together, it started to diminish because 20 minutes after this service is over, we're having to start pack things up and get it out of the room. And then you got to move out of the way. And so it started to change the culture. What happened over the last few weeks is we were blessed to keep the facility set up, and I saw those numbers going back up, and I saw people, more and more people praying together and hanging out together. And guys, none of that is okay, so we need to build a building so we have an extra hour after the service. Of course not, right? All of that symbolizes the togetherness that we see God building together here at Cornerstone. And whether that's an hour after the service, or all of Sunday afternoon or Sunday night, or throughout the week because we have kids that are playing, that are inviting friends to play in a dodgeball tournament, or we have just groups that are getting together to talk and pray together, to teach on parenting or financial planning, or just there's opportunity that we do not have. What we learned over a year ago, and what led the elders together to decide to pursue even building our own space, was our facility impacts our culture as a church, because our culture is so unique. And not like we're the only ones who've invented togetherness, I'm not saying that, but our culture is very unique. So what we did is we bought this piece of property, we're praying about how God might raise up a building on that property that looks, for all intents and purposes, like what we have here. I'm not going to go into the details because we don't have those details yet, but it's a simple building about this size. We don't want to be a big church. We want to be a family of God, but we want to be able to use it like we use our homes. You invite your neighbors into your homes. You invite your families into your homes. You invite coworkers or classmates or your kids' friends in the hopes that they will see a difference in your home that they wouldn't see in a home that wasn't anchored to the rock that is Jesus Christ. It's no different in the family of God. We just want a place that we can come to together throughout the week, and that we can invite other people into throughout the week that can be used for the glory of the gospel. And facility, even this facility is as blessed as we are to be here, compared to where we were before, even in how it's set up, has changed our culture a little bit. There are Sundays where I'll be like, man, so-and-so really left early after church today. Are they doing okay? Do they have an emergency? And one of my daughters will say, no, they didn't leave. They were just outside. Well, the problem is the way this facility is set up, when you're outside, you're outside. Like, there's no connection to us. It's just disconnected. What we had at our old facility, what we're praying God will raise up on this piece of property, is a place where the facility's set up, and not just the building, but you'll see, and don't worry about where all the boxes are, and that map is in the back table, actually, but don't worry about where all the boxes are. Our civil engineer and our architect, who is Jay Silverberg, are working right now to figure out the site plan that we want to submit to the county in September, and that's why I'm talking about it today, because I want us to be praying about that, and I'll get to that in a second, but don't worry about where all the specific, but if you just look at the site, and you look at even the part of the site that isn't the necessary parking that we'd have to have for 350 people or whatever it would be, most of it is outdoor space where we would do life together even outdoors, because that's a huge part of, again, we got a lot of kids, and so that's just part of what we would be able to do there, that even a place like this, as blessed as we are to be here, does not offer that up. And I could go on and on about that, and I've taken more time than I wanted to on that anyway, but here's why I'm sharing it, because what we're in the process of doing right now is we're in the process of finalizing the site plan that we will submit to the county. And there are things specific that we would ask you to be praying for. And on the back, on this map that is on the back table there by the stage, there is a list of specific things, like just some of the stuff I've already shared, some prayer requests and things. I'd ask you to look at that. If you want that emailed to you, there's an email address that you can send. Hey, can you email me the prayer request? And I'd be happy to, and we'd be happy to send that to you so you know specifically what to be praying for. But be praying for favor with the county so that they would, when we submit our plan, they would be overly generous to us in not for having us do a lot of extra stuff. Because so far, we've been able to move this project along by the grace of God and His provision at such a, and this is not me, this is the team that's putting this together, a wise way that is being an excellent steward of the resources God is providing. And I'll just leave it at that. So, last thing I wanted to mention, so also on that table, and to help you remember, there's a bunch of rocks with verses tied to the top of them. The rocks came from the piece of property. We were out on one of our prayer times out there. We gathered up a bunch of rocks. Some of the ladies in our church and kids put these together with some verses. You can put your own verse in them if you want. But I would ask everyone, at least every family here, to take one or more of them with you. Take it home. Put it somewhere on your counter, somewhere in your house that will remind you to be praying that the lighthouse of the gospel would be raised up. Last thing I want to say is a quote. I read a book a little over a year ago as God was really stirring my heart about this idea of corporate witness. And it was by New Testament scholar Jay Hellerman is his name. He wrote a book called When the Church Was a Family. He did a huge study on what the New Testament church looked like during the time of Jesus and the apostles. And he said this. This was the quote that stuck out to me, and I'll close with this and then I'll pray. He says, if your church culture focuses primarily on single-handedly winning non-Christians to faith, set a better example. Pray that when God brings a friend of yours to Christ, your church community will have so embraced him that he wouldn't actually know who won him to the faith. Let's pray. Father, I thank you for the truth that I see evidence of that sitting in this room even today. We're sure one of your faithful servants that's a part of our family went out and engaged with a life, but that then invited them into the family of God here. And when they witness what is going on around here, they feel the presence of your Spirit. And that has been used by you to draw them into the family of faith. Lord, we see that over and over again. Lord, I pray that would increase massively. Lord, we know that it is not about a building or a piece of property. That is just a tool that you would use. But Lord, we also know that those tools are used by you mightily in a massive way. There is a desperate need for the gospel light in the Northwest Valley. There is a need for churches that are not only going to proclaim the truth of God's word and the gospel, but are going to live out the truth of God's word and the gospel. Lord, we come to you and together as brothers and sisters, as sons and daughters of you, Lord, we come to you and we say, we are committed to being a lighthouse for the gospel. So because of that commitment that you have placed on our hearts, we pray that you would raise up a building that would be a beacon of light to a world that lives in darkness. And we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.